I hope you're doing well. We are continuing our study in the book of Revelation. We will be in chapter 4. And I think it's helpful just to pause for a moment before we start reading chapter 4, because the scene in chapter 4 shifts pretty dramatically from chapters 1 through 3. And that shift in scenery sometimes causes us to all of a sudden forget that this letter is, and this book is really addressed to seven particular concrete, living, breathing churches in first century Roman Empire. When we lose sight that this is addressed to the particular realities of those churches living in that day, and that these signs and symbols and language would have been things that they could observe in the world around them, we sometimes begin to take those symbols out of their context and try to find those symbols and signs and the things that we're uncertain about, we try to place them in our world and make some kind of conjecture about what's happening and how that matches up with Revelation or doesn't, and all those kinds of realities. In fact, there's a lot of bad malpractice, I think, in terms of interpreting the book of Revelation in this way. And it's happened for the last couple hundred years, especially there's just been a huge interpretive tradition that has developed in the last probably 200 years or so, starting with Darby in England and then coming over to the United States a little bit later after that. But I think what it does is it begins to twist what this book is all about. It becomes a book of fear rather than a book of hope. It becomes a book of wariness and trying to scan the societies around us and trying to figure out how everything's going to play out, rather than seeing how God is already at work and who we are called to be in response to that. So keep in mind that this is written to churches that are dealing with difficulties and specific situations and challenges in their communities. And this is not necessarily written for us to begin using as an interpretive lens to try to figure out what's happening around us in the same kinds of ways that sometimes we have utilized it as. That doesn't mean it doesn't have something to say to us, but rather we have to understand what it's trying to say to these seven churches and then use that to begin to help us understand what it means to live as God's people in the world on God's terms now. Having said that, let's jump into chapter 4 and begin reading. And it says, "After this, I looked, and there in heaven, a door stood open. And the first voice which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, 'Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this.' At once I was in the Spirit, and there in heaven stood a throne with one seated on the throne. And the one seated there looked like jasper and carnelian, and around the throne is a rainbow that looks like an emerald. Around the throne are 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones are 24 elders dressed in white robes with golden crowns on their heads. Coming from the throne are flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder, and in front of the throne burn seven flaming torches, which are the seven spirits of God, and in front of the throne there's something like a sea of glass, like crystal. Around the throne, and on each side of the throne are four living creatures, full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature is like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature with a face like a human face, and the fourth living creature like a flying eagle. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and inside, day and night, without ceasing they sing, 'Holy, holy, holy, the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.' And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to the one who's seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall before the one who is seated on the throne and worship the one who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, singing, 'You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created.' And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." I think it's helpful, again, to understand that this book is really addressing these seven churches who are undergoing different challenges. Some of them are trying to figure out how to live in the culture in such a way that they're not being shifted towards desire for that culture. Others are experiencing persecution. Some are finding themselves apathetic. There's all sorts of challenges that are present in these churches. And these first three chapters have addressed those churches to help them understand who they're called to be and to wake up in some sense, for God is walking in their midst. Well, now the scene has shifted, and it says that John, after this, looks, and there in heaven, a door stood open. Now, the book of Revelation is apocalyptic literature. Apocalyptic, or apocalypse, we have often utilized to mean something that is like a violent overthrowing, rupturing of reality and all that, and it's kind of has a scary connotation to it. Now, it can certainly be that. It can be disorienting and in some ways scary, especially if you find yourself in a position of power and privilege and all those kinds of things. It can be very disorienting and scary. But for God's people, apocalypse is actually a literature of hope. What apocalypse actually means is an unveiling. So think of a curtain that has kind of been closed over a stage. And once that curtain is pulled back, you can see what was behind it. You can see what was now revealed in the larger scene on the platform or the stage. Well, John has this kind of similar reality. There in heaven is a door that's open. Heaven for the Jewish people is not something that is disembodied. It's not something that's far off and distant. That's a Greek idea that we then take and use in our own kind of theology of heaven. But rather for the Jewish people, heaven was always really near, sometimes imperceptible and sometimes seemingly at a distance. But in reality, there are these thin places like the Holy of Holies and the Ark of the Covenant and Mount Sinai, where heaven and earth are touching, where they are not divided out, but the veil has been pulled back and God is revealed. And those moments are transformational. Well, here is another one of those moments. The veil has been torn, and not just in one particular moment for John, but we will find out that veil has been torn completely in the person of Jesus. Now heaven and earth are no longer separated, but the reign of God has commenced in the person of Jesus. It has begun. It's already inaugurated. And so John walks through this open door in the power of the Spirit, and what he sees is this tremendously awesome scene of God's glory, enthroned, surrounded by 24 elders. Now, the description of God on this throne is one of costly jewels, carnelian, and all that kind of stuff. And the base of the throne is one of a rainbow. You get this sense of God's promise in Noah's day that God was for creation, not against it. And that promise seems to be what God is enthroned upon. That God's way in the world is one of redemption and not of violence to destroy it. So here, gathered around the throne are 24 elders. These 24 elders, of course, are representative of the 12 tribes of Israel and the 12 disciples, which in some sense is representative of God's people across time in all times and places. And so gathered around God are God's people. And then behind that is the four beasts, or the four creatures. There's one that looks like a lion, there's one that looks like an ox, one that has human features, and one that is like an eagle, which is to say all of creation. The lion is the kind of predatory animals, the ox are the beast of burden, the eagles are obviously representative of the birds of the air, humanity is included in that. In other words, all of creation is gathered around the throne room of God as well. Now, the scene is almost like it's facing the person reading it. So you see God in the center, the 24 elders, the creatures, and so on and so forth in this kind of widening ring, which would have been a similar scene for those that would have observed Caesar of Rome when he was giving a dictate holding a scroll, which we'll see scrolls later on. But he would have been seated in the middle on his throne, and then gathered around him would have been elders and representatives of the community and so on and so forth in this kind of ever-growing ring. So what is being revealed here, what the apocalypse is in John, in the revealing of the pulling back of the curtain, is that God is enthroned. And what we might have for the seven churches might have suspected to be true, that Caesar is in charge of the world, that Caesar, who makes the rules and the laws and all those kinds of things and makes life very difficult at times, in reality is a pseudo king. He is not a real king. He's a false lord. In fact, that was kind of what one of the things that they would claim about Caesar. Caesar is Lord. But the apocalyptic nature of this, the revelation in this, is that Caesar isn't Lord. God is. God is Lord over all creation. And God is seated in the place of power and dominion and authority, ultimately. That God's reign has already been inaugurated. The curtain has been pulled back. And the places of God's presence have become available to any, really. So this scene is one of worship and glorification. It is one where the glory of God is on display. It says that the creatures begin to sing a song and to glorify God. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Heaven and earth are full of his glory. So not just heaven, but also earth, that God's presence is there both in heaven and earth, that the thin places has become a reality. One of the other kind of realities in this particular vision that John has is there's a crystal sea that's by the throne. Seas are, waters are chaotic kind of realities. And so for the Jewish mindset or the Jewish reader, they would have understood waters as dangerous. They would have understood waters as chaotic realities. But the fact that this is a crystal sea and there doesn't seem to even be a slight ripple in it gives this sense that God in some place and time will have calmed the chaos so that the waters are calm, that life is possible. In fact, when you look at the flood narrative in Genesis 9 and 10, right around there, when the waters come collapsing in on themselves, the chaos and the destruction that fall because of humanity's violence, when God begins to redeem creation or save creation through Noah, those waters begin to separate out again and recede. And it takes some time, but dry land appears. And so this taming of chaos is a story that happens in Genesis twice. It happens in the story of Exodus, where Moses and his people walk across dry land to escape from Pharaoh. The waters are parted, the seas are calm. And it happens in the person of Jesus as he's walking on the waters and Peter comes out to him and he says, "Peace be still," and the waters calm themselves. This is the reign of God, that God will ultimately bring an end to the chaos and chaos will no longer rule. And in the midst of this, all of creation sings, no longer groaning under the weight of its oppression, but singing out the glory of God in unison. And as all of creation begins to do this, the 24 elders join in and begin to also worship God, singing the same kinds of song, echoing the refrain that creation sings. And they say, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive honor and glory and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." Now, this story is really important for understanding the whole rest of the book of Revelation, which is really a story, a book about God's glory. It's a worship book. It's a hymn book. It is a reminder that for these communities that are experiencing difficult days, that really the reality that has been established in the person of Jesus is that God is ultimately Lord. And that as we are gathered as God's people to worship together, we are already participating in that great banquet of the Lamb. We are participating in the praise and worship of God's people and all of creation. That we are living as citizens of a kingdom that has not yet been fully realized, in the sense that God's has not totally fulfilled all the promises that were given, that to restore and redeem all of creation. That's still an ongoing work in some realities, but at the same time, it's already been accomplished in the person of Jesus. And so although we wait for the completion of that, that work has already been inaugurated. And as citizens of the kingdom, we are called to lean into this reality of worship and reality that we cast our crowns down. That's the only thing they're good for, casting our crowns down at the feet of the throne and finding our place in the great throng of worship among the elders and the creatures and the angels, and that our lives on earth are geared towards worship, And really, in many ways, to recognize that the powers of this world are temporary, that they are ultimately not ultimate. They are not the end. And so we should do well to pay attention as a community, not to get deceived and begin to follow the ways of Caesar, but to begin to live out the ways of God, which begins first and foremost in worship, recognition of who God is, and that God sits on the throne. Well, I hope this was an encouraging word for you today. May God bless you and keep you.